Joseph Ferdinand Doeve was born in Bandung, Indonesia in 1907, but he later became better known by his nickname Eppo. At the time, Indonesia was a Dutch colony, and although both his parents were Dutch citizens, they were also of multiracial backgrounds. Throughout his childhood, Doeve had shown a clear talent for drawing and painting, but in his later teens he went on to study agronomy at Wageningen University in Holland, aiming for a career as a tea planter. But when the Wall Street stock market crashed in 1929, the resulting economic crisis caused the collapse of the Indonesian tea market, and he quickly changed his plans. And although entirely self-taught, he decided to attempt a career in illustration. He had already had a couple of illustrations commissioned by an Amsterdam advertising agency, and he designed this remarkably accomplished, graphically stylized poster in 1930, when he would have been 23 years old. Within a year, he was regularly producing mostly humorous line illustrations for the Haga Post. And in 1933, he became a political cartoonist at the Groener Amsterdammer, which is where this early satire of Adolf Hitler was published. In the years that followed, he continued to produce a large volume of political cartoons, but even at this early stage of his career, he demonstrated great stylistic versatility, and also created more advertising work in the form of posters and press ads, as well as numerous ex libris book plates, many of which were skillfully created in scraperboard. Not all his magazine work was political, and in the 1930s he also worked regularly for the Dutch radio guide Radio Boda. He produced many monochrome illustrations promoting the serial Paul Vlaanderen, a Dutch version of the detective character Paul Temple, originally created by British writer Francis Durbridge. And although printed quite small in pen and ink line with occasional half-tone dot screens, he brought the same diligence and graphic authority to these comic book style panels as he did to bigger budget and more prestigious commissions. When World War II began in 1939, Holland declared themselves to be neutral, but even so they were occupied by German forces in 1940. I found very few examples of his work from the war years, but even the small amount I did find was stylistically varied. By this point, he was also working as an artist, creating rather surreal portraits, and he also painted his first mural at this time. It's guesswork on my part, but it might be that given his earlier graphic mockery of the Führer, Doeve was trying to keep his head down during the occupation. Following the end of the war, he resumed his usual level of activity, and in 1946 he worked with the writer Bertus Aftjes on the fairy tale comic strip Het Mannetje Bagatelle. Like his Paul Vlaanderen illustrations, the frames were created as clean linear drawings, using dot screens again, based on Doeve's blue wash guides on the original artwork. But at this time it was poster design which really began to dominate his output. And from this point on, he would be a significant and ubiquitous graphic presence on the walls of Dutch cities and towns. In 1947, he was commissioned to create a series of posters for Artist Zoo in Amsterdam, and he came up with a collection of particularly striking graphic studies of various animals, which were immensely popular and, naturally enough, attracted many other clients. A year later, he created both this cheerful image of a cartoon penguin for an apple drink, and yet another for Heineken beer, which was just as entertaining and even more enduringly popular. Although in his work as an artist he favoured the use of oil paint, the great majority of his commercial work was created using gouache and occasionally watercolours. All his posters exhibited remarkable levels of control of his medium and its application. They were usually tonal in nature, and although most appear to have been created by traditional brushwork, there are several examples which use flawless tonal transitions and strongly suggest he was no stranger to the mechanical airbrush. However they were created, they were uniformly masterful demonstrations of the clear readability and dynamic composition vital to success in this arena of commercial expression. And although he had to an extent absorb the influence of French master of the poster A.M. Cassandre, he was certainly no mere copyist, and added as much if not more of his own powerful aesthetic consideration and technique to the designs. Given that he simultaneously continued to work as an artist and for his magazine clients, this volume of varied and immersive poster work constituted a truly remarkable creative achievement. But this prolific torrent of poster design appears to have stalled in 1953, even if only for a few years. And in that year, he concerned himself more with various other projects, including the prestigious commission to redesign Dutch banknotes. And for this series of images, he produced portraits of famous historical Dutch figures set against symbolic background elements. His original images were transcribed into the spectacularly fine engravings required for monetary printing, and naturally enough, this project brought him yet more celebrity status and respect. Also in the 1950s, his restless creative urge took him into other territories, including theatrical costume and particularly striking stage set design for a number of theatrical productions. Doeve worked as an artist throughout his life, and the many paintings he created make for fascinating viewing. Much of his art was portraiture, which was possessed of a calm and occasionally unsettling atmosphere. And although always representational and skillfully rendered, some made use of his talent for comedic exaggeration, frequently to be seen in his commercial work. As an artist, he enjoyed reasonable and deserved success in his lifetime, and although his paintings were never as popular as his more accessible illustrations, in the 1950s he created impressive murals in a range of styles from neoclassical to more hard-edged industrial modern, which were very well received by critics and the public. In 1955 he was commissioned to illustrate a calendar for the British brewery company Whitbread, and he responded to the commission with a dozen floral themed compositions which were highly decorative and visually compelling. Some were painted as still life, but the majority incorporated scenic elements to great effect, and these more complex compositions radiated the same sense of stillness and quiet as his figure paintings. In the following year, the children's book Pier, written by Pete Bakker, was published. And his crayon doodles for this book couldn't have been more different from the precision and total brushwork of his flower paintings. So much so that I doubt anyone would even suspect they were the creation of the same person. Around this time, he was producing other stylistically diverse images, including some charming pictures for children's annuals, using yet another otherwise unseen and highly attractive stylistic approach. And in 1959, he was also commissioned to create an impressive modernist mural for the Dutch airline company KLM. Doeve had by now become a well-known and popular figure in post-war Holland, and in the later 1950s he began appearing on various TV shows, sometimes making comical pictures while on set and sometimes just being a witty guest. But perhaps most significantly in the later 1950s, he designed a series of compelling book covers for the publisher's Prisma. This particularly compelling illustration was for an edition of H.G. Wells' Time Machine, and other designs followed in rapid succession. And whether it was for fiction or non-fiction, he consistently found evocative and absorbing graphic solutions, as he had with his earlier posters. He continued to design many more stylish and memorable book covers into the 1960s, and the aesthetic authority and intuitive design consciousness evident in these images has guaranteed an enduring and timeless appeal. And this body of illustrative designs would not look dated on contemporary bookshelves. In 1962, he illustrated Little Isar, the Fourth King, in collaboration with Bertus Afjes, which was published by Elsevier's Weekblad as a Christmas comic. As in Doeve's previous comic strip work, he kept the images graphic and simple, and the story was successful enough to be published in several other European countries. As the 1960s wore on, it seemed he lost none of his popularity or creative ability, and the work he produced throughout the decade was every bit as varied and accomplished as his earlier output. So everything from posters, books, magazines, and more portraits and murals continued to proliferate. In 1971, he undertook the considerable task of creating a series of panels which formed a spectacularly long narrative mural for the town hall of the town of Huizen. By this time, the visual evidence suggests he was no longer in the same demand for posters and book design, but his magazine work, most of it political, for Elsevier Weekblad and others, continued as before. Nevertheless, in 1975, he created a series of distinctive illustrations for some of Hans Andersen's fairy tales, using a combination of inkline and watercolour washes, some of which were flat and some more tonally applied. The last verified image I found was this satirical magazine illustration from 1980. And following a 50-year prolific career, Eppo Doeve died in 1981 at the age of 73. Following his death, a large cache of artwork and unpublished images was found stored away in every available drawer and cupboard space of his studio, with no concern that they might be of value. Eppo Doeve was by no means the first or last illustrator to have stumbled into the profession, but tea planting loss has undoubtedly been the illustration's gain, and however accidental his career may have been, he remains one of the most significant and distinctive graphic stylists of the 20th century. Many illustrators settle for one definitive approach to their work, and some might have a second string to their bow. Very few could demonstrate the same level of endless fascination for and dexterity with a range of techniques and media as Eppo Doeve. And although there are many who may aspire to such versatility, there are significantly fewer who have the range of skills to achieve it with anything approaching the same degree of creative success.